I wanted to talk a little bit more about deep learning and some of the kind of slightly more large and interesting architectures that have been coming along in the last couple of years, last few years. So just a very brief recap, right? We've got videos on this. I'm going to draw my network from the top down this time. So rather than there being a square input image, I'm just going to draw a line, which is the image from the top. And so you can work all your animation magic and sort this all out for me. Brilliant. So I'm going to be talking about deep learning and convolutional neural networks. So a convolutional neural network is one where you have some input, like an image, you filter it using a convolution operation, and then you repeat that process a number of times to learn something interesting about that image, some interesting features, and then you make a classification decision based on it. That is usually what you do, right? So you might decide, well, this has got a cat in it, or this one's got a dog in it, or this one's got a cat and a dog in it, and that's very exciting. So from the top down, right, because otherwise my pen's gonna run out of ink if I start trying to do too many boxes, you've got an input image that's quite large, usually. So here's an input image, and I'm gonna draw it like this. This is from the top. So if this is my image, I'm gonna go to the top and look at it straight down, which I realized, sort of like that. Does that work? Now, there's three input channels, because of course we have usually red, green, and blue. Right. So in some sense, this is multidimensional. We're gonna have our little filtering, so I'm gonna draw a couple of kernels. Let's maybe draw four. We're gonna do a convolution operation using this one on here. So it's gonna look over all of these three channels, it's gonna scan along, and it's gonna calculate some kind of features, like an edge or something like this, and that's gonna produce another feature. Right, and now there's four kernels, so they're each going to do this, so we're going to have four outputs. Don't worry, I'm not going to do an 800 layer deep network this way. So each of these gets to look at all of the three. Something that's a bit of a sort of quirk of deep learning, but maybe isn't explained often enough. But actually, these have an extra dimension that lets them look at these. So the next layer along will look at all four of these ones, and so on. What we also then do, and I'm going to sort of why not use multiple colors? We then sometimes also spatially downsample. So we take the maximum of a region of pixels so that we can make the whole thing smaller and fit it better on our graphics card. We're gonna downsample this, so it's gonna look like this. And then, okay, I'll just do a yellow one, why not? Can we see yellow on this?
We'll soon find out.
Yeah, yeah. So let's say there's two kernels here, and you can kind of see it.
I think we need to go pink here.
Pink, all right, pink, forget yellow. No yellow on white, that was what I was told when I first started using PowerPoint, like pink. Oh, that can work. It kind of looks a bit like the red. So that's going to look at all these four. So, and there's two of them, so there's going to be two outputs, right? Just think of it in terms of four inputs, two outputs. So that's going to be sort of like this. I'm just going to go back to my blue and forget the colors now. And you just repeat this process for quite a while, right? Depending on the network. There are more advanced architectures like ResNets that let this become very, very deep. Hundreds of layers sometimes, but for the sake of argument, let's just say it's into the dozens usually. So we're going to downsample a bit more and so on, and then we'll get some kind of final feature vector, hopefully a summary of everything that's in all these images, sort of summarized for us, and that's where we do our classification. So we attach a little neural network to this here, and that all connects to all of these, and then this is our reading of whether it's a cat or not. That's the idea. The problem with this is that these number of connections here are fixed. This is the big drawback of this kind of network. You're using this to do this very interesting feature calculation, and then you've got this fixed number. There's always three here, there's always one here. So this always has to be the same size, which means that this input also has to always be the same size. Let's say 256 pixels by 256 pixels, which is not actually very big. So what tends to happen is that we take our image that we're interested in, and we shrink it to 256 by 256 and put that in. And so when we train our network, we make a decision early on as to what kind of appropriate size we should use. Now, of course, it doesn't really make any sense currently because we have lots of different kinds of sizes of image. Obviously, they can't be too big because we'll run out of RAM, but it would be nice if it was a little bit flexible. The other issue is that this is actually taking our entire image and summarizing it in one value. So all spatial information is lost. Right? You can see that the spatial information is getting lower and lower as we go through this network, to the point where all we care about is if it's a cat, not where is the cat. What if we wanted to find out where the cat was, or segment the cat, or segment the person, or count the number of people, right? To do that, this isn't going to work because it always goes down to one.
So that's kind of a yes or no, isn't it?
Yeah, yes or no. You could have multiple outputs if it was yes dog, no cat, different outputs. Sometimes instead of a classification, you output an actual value, like the amount of something, but in this case, let's not worry about it. Now, you've told me that this is an erasable marker, so I'm gonna have a go at this. Has anyone ever erased your marker in your videos? I mean, this is a first, right? Okay, it's working. It's just going to take quite a while because this rubber is tiny. You know what? I quite like these markers. It's all right. There we go. All right, so the same input still produces this little feature vector, but now instead of a fixed size neural network on the end, we're just going to put another convolution of 1 pixel by 1 pixel. So it's just a tiny little filter, but it's just 1 by 1. And that's going to scan over here and produce an image of exactly the same size. But this, of course, will be looking through all of these and working out in detail what the object is. So it'll have much more information than these ones back here. So, you know, this could be outputting a heat map of where the cats are or where the dogs are, or, you know, areas of disease in this sort of a medical image or something like this. And so this is called a fully convolutional network because there are no longer any fully connected or fixed size layers in this network. So normal deep learning, in some sense, or at least up until sort of 2014, 2015, predominantly just put a little neural network on the end of this that was a fixed size. Now, we don't do that. And the nice thing is, if we double the size of this input image, I mean, we're using more RAM, but this is going to double, this will double, and in the end, this will also double. And we'll just get the exact same result, but just bigger. So we can now put in different size images. The way this actually works in practice is that when your deep learning library like Caffe2 or PyTorch or TensorFlow will allocate memory as required. So you put in an input image and it goes, well, okay, with that input image, we're going to need to allocate this much RAM to do all this. And so the nice thing is that this can now have information on where the objects are as well as what they are, right? Pixel output. So we'll show a few examples of semantic segmentation on the screen so you can see the kind of thing we're talking about. The obvious downside here, which is what I'm going to leave for another video, is that this is very, very small. You know, maybe this is only a few pixels by a few pixels or something like this. Or you haven't done that much downsampling, and so it's not a very deep network and you haven't learned a whole lot.
If you were looking for where is the cat in this image, you'd have kind of, it's down in the bottom left.
It would be very, very general. So it would be, you know, this sort of area, maybe there's something else going on over here. It depends on the resolution of this image.
It looks great with different colours and lines on paper, but what are you actually using this stuff for?
All right. So, I mean, we have to extend this slightly, which I'm, you know, annoyingly going to postpone for another video, because this is too small for us to be practical, right? What we could do is just upsample this. We could use linear or bilinear interpolation to just make this way bigger, like this, and have a bigger output image. And it would still be very low resolution. You'd get the rough idea of where something was, but it wouldn't be great, right? So you could use this to find objects that you're looking for. So for example, in our lab, we're using this for things like analysis of plants. So where are the wheat ears? How many are there? That can be useful in a field to try and work out what the yield or the disease problems are going to be. You can do it for medical images. Where are the tumors in this image? Segmenting X-ray images. We're also doing it on human pose estimation and face estimation. So, you know, where is the face in this image? Where are the eyes? What shape is the face? This kind of thing. So you can use this for a huge amount of things, but we're going to need to extend it a little bit more to get the best out of it. And the extension we'll call an encoder-decoder network.
Are you tying it up now? What are you doing?
It's not neat enough. I've got, there's little bits of unrubbed out bits. Bear with me. We'll start on the next video in a minute. that's as good as it's going to get.